If your isolated desert settlement was plagued by the sand version of the infamous Alaskan bullworm, what would you do? 90s Kevin Bacon and his buddy Earl were trying to seek out greener pastures beyond the confines of their ironically named town of Perfection, Nevada, with all of its 14 residents and no hopes of a brighter tomorrow, when giant worms picked off the Graboid Homeowners Association, who don't wish to see their land's value plummet. The dynamic duo find out that they should have been constructing worm fencing all along. I'm going to break down the mistakes made, what you should do, and how to beat the Graboids in Tremors.
We are handy men.
We start out following Val and Earl, hard at work constructing fences in the vast Nevadan desert wilderness. You know, in case they need to mark the confines of the wide-open nothing in this barren stretch of land. Oh wait, did I say hard at work? I meant hardly working. Apparently, this is how these guys start their day off. Wake up in the back of a pickup, and then play rock, paper, scissors to determine who's responsible for preventing starvation on that particular day. They then hammer all of one fence post into the dirt, and on to the next task they go. As it turns out, their next task involves stopping in the middle of nowhere to do some 90s bacon flirting.
Yeah, geography.
Geology.
Actually, seismology.
Stereotype seismologist Sunscreen on the Nose Barbie tells the duo that she's been sent out here to observe strange readings that they've been getting on their seismographs. Considering Perfection, Nevada is actually Lone Pine, California, that makes perfect sense. The actual area this was filmed in sits on the Lone Pine Fault, in between valleys. Earthquakes do definitely occur in the area, albeit usually quite minor ones. That being said, the area has definitely experienced some devastating quakes as well, such as the 1872 Owens Valley earthquake that destroyed literally half the houses in Lone Pine. This would likely have me taking her strange readings a bit more seriously, just in case. They hop on over to the general store, aka the only store in a 100-mile radius. All that hard work is certainly deserving of a beer run after all. There they run into Bert and Heather Gummer, the survivalist nuts of the town, as they're counting their hollow points and survival supplies. Ah yes, my kind of people. Speaking of crappy jobs, our two smooth-talking jagoffs have had enough and are about to leave their middle-of-nowhere town behind for Bixby, the nearby big city everyone's taken charge of their own fortunes in.
Edgar, get your butt down from there!
Nerds, I've been seeing more and more comments asking how I can possibly sleep at night after hypothetically abandoning so many annoying characters to suffer unimaginable fates. Well, the truth is, like an absolute boulder. And it's all thanks to my chilling lack of empathy, as well as today's video sponsor, Manta Sleep. Manta Sleep is planet Earth's foremost supplier of everything you need to enhance your sleeping experience. From high-quality sleep masks with optional cooling eye cups, to travel pillows, earplugs, and even blue light glasses for those of us getting just a little too much screen time. Manta Sleep has made it their mission to help people live healthier, happier lives by delivering the tools to achieve consistent and uninterrupted rest. After all, 9 out of 10 doctors agree that sleep is very important, and the 10th one just passed out from exhaustion. Seriously though, getting enough rest is outright essential for both maintaining and improving every aspect of your physical and mental well-being. And even if you're already satisfied with your current amount of sleep, just think of it this way. You're probably spending about a third of your life horizontal. Don't you want to get as much out of that time as possible? I know I do. That's why I never leave home without my Manta Sound sleep mask. Whether I'm conking out on a plane, in a hotel, or in my own bed, I always wake up feeling refreshed and ready to tackle whatever life throws my way. It also comes in handy when reviewing particularly terrible movies, as do the earplugs. So if you're ready to supercharge your slumber, click the link in the description and be sure to use my offer code, NERDEXPLAINS, to get 10% off your cart at checkout. Keep in mind, this code does not apply to bundled items, as they've already been generously discounted. Thanks to Manta Sleep for sponsoring this video. As they hit the road and get ready to drive down the Nevada desert, they notice a human silhouette above them near the power lines, seemingly having fallen asleep on the job or something. Upon closer examination, it turns out to be Edgar Deems, one of their buddies, and the local town drunk. In fact, probably the only town drunk here. He appears to have died trying to stay off the ground, judging by his clutching grip on that beam. Not sure what he was afraid of, considering he died beside his rifle. Or maybe he was just looking to end it all and got scared, but didn't know how to get down anymore. Who knows? That certainly would appear to be possible, as the local doctor, Jim, says he died due to dehydration, meaning he was likely indeed afraid to climb down for some reason. Perhaps he urinated on someone's motorcycle and just wanted to avoid an altercation. After all, 7% of the population of your town out to kill you sounds pretty awful if you think about it. Jokes aside, I'd initially brush this down to just a drunken adventure gone wrong, with alcohol-fueled dehydration and a desert climate ultimately doing the old man in. The fact that we didn't find any bullet casings anywhere around electrical poles bizarre. As Val and Earl call out later, who isn't scared of a Winchester rifle? It's still very hard to come to the right conclusion with the amount of information at hand, but I can't help but wonder why old man Edgar didn't fire his rifle at all. Whether at the threat at hand directly or simply in the air to ensure that you can alert someone to your emergency situation. I'd imagine gunshots in a quiet rural town like this would likely attract some attention. The town residents would maybe also just brush it off as their gun nuts doing some target practice though, and not look any further into it initially. But sooner or later, they'd figure it out. The whole 3 to 4 days to die of dehydration is total bullcrap as well. Most people don't make it through the first 36 hours in the desert without water, and nobody makes it past 72 hours. That's under normal circumstances. Factor in the old man's age, exhaustion from running away plus climbing the pole, and the fact that he was an alcoholic, and you'd be speeding that timeline up significantly. I can't imagine someone in that general physical condition would last longer than 24 hours up there tops. Alcoholic musings aside, I wouldn't have any reason to assume that there's any foolery afoot just yet. Perhaps Mr. Mary and his little lambs will manage to change my mind. He's just minding his own business, tending to his already audibly freaked out rare kebabs. The old geezer doesn't even get the chance to figure out what's ailing his soon-to-be wool sweaters before a rogue creature drags him down to the depths below to serve for all of eternity as a flash-fried desert-baked shepherd's pie. Mocking the son of a shepherd was no big deal to this mysterious creature. In fact, they have no problem at all with turning the residents of perfection into nothing more than lines on a seismograph. At least you could argue that there was technically a witness to his untimely demise in the form of Rhonda. Issue is, she probably wouldn't be able to figure this one out before the other 12 residents of the town meet the same fate, since it's nothing a seismologist would reasonably expect. What the Fortunately, our two heroes stumble upon the aftermath on their way out of town. I say fortunately because at least now someone can confirm the fact that the shepherd didn't just go missing or something. There's literally pieces of lamb just thrown everywhere, along with Fred's severed head in the sand. That is pretty damning. Where these two again demonstrate their kind of impressive lack of functioning brain cells is passing the construction crew on the one road out of this town and not adequately warning them of the danger. They just mumble some crap about a killer being on the loose, instead of actually slowing down and telling the construction crew that you just found at least a dozen dismembered sheep scattered all over Fred's farm, along with his severed head. These guys would know who Fred is. Describing the horrific way in which you just found his remains would 100% increase your credibility tenfold. Literal street cred in this case is all it would have taken to make the difference. Instead, the crew just assume it's a gag for the most part and keep drilling into the road with their trusty jackhammer. The road responds by leaking blood? Hey man, maybe you just found some fancy red oil or something. You know, that red gold. Or not. The unfortunate road worker was so blown away by the prospect of striking gold that he didn't manage to get his foot out of the conveniently created loop in the jackhammer's cable, getting him dragged over the hills and far away. Well, technically speaking, he's not going to be needing another penny for the rest of his life, so I wasn't entirely incorrect when I said his money problems are over. His buddy tries to help him out, wanting some of that financial freedom for himself, getting turned into yet another line on a seismograph. That's 21% of the population of this town dead, with another 14% ready to GTFO. Val and Earl make it back to the general store, trying to inform nearby police departments of the attempted cleansing taking place in their quiet town. Turns out these creatures are 99% brains though, as they've seemingly thought to cut communications ahead of their attacks. When the Baconator duo tries to get to Bixby again, only this time to signal rescue instead, they also find out their adversaries have blocked the roads out of town. Well, more like the only road out of town, seeing as this town is surrounded by mountains on all sides except for this one road. That shouldn't necessarily be the end of the world here though, particularly when just about everyone in this town drives vehicles suited for off-road conditions. So just, go around. In spite of the danger slowly but surely becoming increasingly clear, Val and Earl can't take the hint. Cut communications, beheaded farmers, dead cattle, only way out of town blocked, with the road workers from just an hour ago now near certainly dead as evidenced by a bloody helmet. These are all but small hindrances and truly no match for the plot armored. Instead of finding a way around and utilizing their vehicle for its intended purpose, the Dream Team makes it back to perfection, hoping to inform the other residents of their impending doom. When they make it back, it turns out they've unsuspectingly picked up a hitchhiker. Cool, so right about here is where you ask the gun nuts to arm everyone capable of holding a firearm in this entire town, which means like 11 people, and start fortifying the strongest building nearby. Considering access to food and supplies, I'd say the general store ought to do it. Should we want a beefier setup, I dare wager the Gummers, being survival nuts and all preparing for World War III, would likely have a pretty fortified house, or at least a reinforced cellar or something. If we're not sure, we could always ask them. Provided it checks out, we can ferry food and water over to their doomsday shelter instead, rather than shipping guns over to the store, provided they actually have that many guns anyway. Even if they don't, there's plenty to go around already, at the store, on the residents, for them to make either of these options work. Instead, Old Man Shang immediately buys it from Earl and Val so he can cook up some extraterrestrial chicken teriyaki for his patrons. Seriously though, who the hell reacts that way? I found our protags relatively smart starting off, compared to other horror movie characters anyway. Their execution may have been awkward, but attempting to seek help and warning others if unable to do so are all valid moves when dealing with a threat of this nature in an isolated community. However, once you see these weird appendages hanging off the back of your truck, knowing full and well that this is not like any normal creature you've ever seen out here, and that a bunch of your people have just turned up dead at the same time, it is officially time to start thinking beyond that. Arming up at the very least would be a minimum requirement here at this stage in the movie. Earl was already keeping a revolver handy after they found Fred earlier, to further prove my point. They also correctly assess that there's a possibility of more than one of these mystery beasts lurking in and around their town, which is why I'd also suggest rounding everybody up in the same location to avoid anyone getting caught out by themselves, because they don't know that they're in danger. Speaking of unarmed, unaware, and exposed, Jim and Megan, the doctor from earlier, and his wife, are taking care of business at their active housing project. As they didn't hear about any of the stuff that went down following Edgar's death, and nobody decided their lives were worth enough to inform them of the danger that they're currently in, they're out blissfully enjoying the fantasy that is near-term homeownership. When they go to check on a power line hidden underneath the dirt, they anger the creature. They see the electrical appliances being violently ejected from the sand and cement. Megan shows us just why women tend to outlive men, urging her husband to leave whatever did that untouched into GTFO instead. Jim's reason for refusing that request is, and I quote, "Maybe it's a geological thing, like natural gas or a geyser." Right. In which case, you would want to leave and have the pros come check it out all the same. This lapse in recognizing danger, combined with the disrespect towards the mystery creature beneath the surface by calling it natural gas, caused Jim to wind up on the receiving end of an alien-produced sinkhole. Through quick thinking and clearly superior intellect, Megan tries to give him a way out by extending a 2x4. In a quicksand situation, this may actually provide a reliable way out for those trapped in the quicksand's hold. However, as Megan finds out shortly after her husband is consumed by the hole, this is not quicksand. She does the smart thing by immediately bolting towards their car, but finds the keys aren't in the ignition. There's no way she could retrieve them off Jim at this point, or find them if they're somewhere else. Therefore, I would suggest rushing towards their project house. Sure, it's not finished, but the foundation's likely concrete, providing some level of fortification against the worm. Instead, she just assumes everything's over as soon as she breaks visual contact with it, which she regrets almost instantly. It's truly the hesitation that got these two killed. Jim was arguably screwed regardless due to the fact that he didn't immediately think something dangerous was underneath his feet, since he had no reason to assume so. Megan, however, could have bolted straight for their house once she broke a visual contact, or she could have simply opened any of the car doors once it started to go vertical, rather than just sit there. Precious seconds can save lives. And with that, we're at 35% of the population liquidated into worm food. You may be wondering what the rest of Perfection's up to, given they actually did have a heads up and a rough idea of what they're dealing with. Well, they're debating stupid political ideologies, posing with the alien tentacle and taking pictures with it, and our star duo is about to try and venture out to Bixby again on horseback instead of by truck. To their credit though, they are at least all held up in the same general area with at least a few guns and a ton of supplies. Bert's right on the money though. Keep watch, set up perimeters, fortify, arm up, and kill anything without two legs. Then there's the insufferable pacifists, who'd rather do nothing while a very serious percentage of their population's already been murdered. And Melvin, who nearly gets himself capped pretending the alien's tentacles wrapping itself around his neck. I would have just... Whoops, he really tricked me with that one. Bacon and Earl depart through the desert on horseback, even though I still wholeheartedly believe that looks drivable at slow speeds with a decent off-road vehicle. They make a pass by the doctor's house on their way out, finding nothing, of course, initially. That is until they find the completely buried Ford in the dirt, which causes them to haul out of town, along the totally off-road vehicle accessible plains. The Graboid threat finally decides to reveal its ugly face when Val shoots one of the tentacles. Those tentacles were basically its tongues, which it uses for hunting purposes.
This is the tongue, and the whole thing is the worm.
The actual worm behind it is enormous. Val and Earl lose access to their horsies, which understandably freaked out beyond function at the mere sight of these things, and find themselves trying to outrun these monstrosities on foot. They hop behind a concrete barrier and learn that the worms have one weakness.
Without their heads, they're powerless!
Basically, this thing smashed itself into a concrete barrier at full force. So much for these worms being intelligent. Maybe the communications cutout was just a bad service provider and totally unrelated to the worms. This does, however, bring us a classic and important detail. Our adversaries can be killed. It appears that they hunt using sound and are attracted to the vibrations above the ground. They burrow towards their prey and use these tiny tentacle tongues to latch onto stuff and then basically collapse onto it. Considering it ran our duo down to its death, it would be more than reasonable to assume that it can be baited into attacking quite easily. It also doesn't require a completely unrealistic amount of force to kill it. So, what should our strategy against a threat of this nature be? I say we hit up the local gun nuts again and give them the mother of all passes to go crazy on some worms. Hell, I'd even offer to subsidize the ammo money with the other residents, seeing as the couple would be saving our lives and all. With the arsenal that they've likely got at hand and the amount of bullets we see them definitely having in stock, they could arm the entire town and provide everyone with reliable firepower to fill these worms full of holes. Considering they're drawn to sound, it's then as simple as either making noise from within a concrete and safe structure to draw them towards you, or you'd set up sound traps using things like radios to lure the Graboids to a specific location. Use different types of bait as well, just in case they're smart enough to recognize the same trick after a few kills. Then, when they show up, you can pump them full of lead. Rinse and repeat.
Hey guys, What's going on?
Val and Earl finally have scientific evidence of what murdered so many in their town. And what do you know? Rhonda conveniently shows up just in time to ensure that they have a scientific opinion on the matter too. How she managed to hold out that long just wandering around in the worm's territory without getting snacked on is beyond me. And she sure looks snackable to me. I'm calling it plot armor. Through scientific examination, Rhonda confirms the obvious, that they hunt by sound and are subterranean. Thanks, Sherlock! She does, however, provide seismographic readings that indicate that there's three more of these things lurking around in the area. No more, no less. She is very sure that it is exactly three. Excellent. That makes my previous strategy with sound traps seem like a piece of cake. Just like the worms wiped out an enormous percentage of their population, Val and Earl have also wiped out 25% of the worms' population just as quickly. We only need to bait out three more and have the gummers blow them to smithereens and we can all go home. This should be easy, because they'd likely be hungry as hell around the clock due to how much energy their existence would consume, making them likely to come looking for us anyway. However, for the sake of reality, it does need to be called out. There is no way animals of this size would be hunter predators at all. Animals of this enormous size would realistically be burning thousands upon thousands of calories just being alive and breathing to power their cells. The kind of diet that these things would have to be on to simply exist would be ridiculous. And that's if they're passive. With all the moving these graboids do in this movie, not to mention the tunneling under the rock solid ground for every single inch, they would likely require insane amounts of energy. With how they're just ravaging buildings and vehicles too, I'd imagine that calorie count would have to be even more amped up to match demand. The characteristics of a hunting predator would be better suited towards smaller variants of these worms. If their genetics insisted on them being big boys for all eternity, they would definitely evolve to be ambush predators over time. That would allow them to conserve all their energy and wait for prey to come to them instead. I'm not sure how fruitful that endeavor would be in Perfection, Nevada, seeing as they'd run out of food in about a week tops given the population. That's if they can get the initial 14 people to all actually walk into one of their traps, which I doubt would happen to begin with. I'm thinking a hybrid between a Sarlacc and Star Wars, and some kind of trapdoor spider is the kind of hunting style that I would see them adopt, if so. Not full Sarlacc, since nobody would ever walk up to the pit, but rather an area in the sand that they make seem like their surrounding topography, before they just slam their mouth shut around their prey and swallow them whole. A bit more alligator style in that regard, except in the desert. Otherwise, these things just wouldn't function. In real life, there's plenty of examples of this, both at sea and on land. Spiders and various other insects are known to camouflage themselves to bring prey within grabbing range, before they just pounce at them and devour their prey whole. Frogfish mimic the motions and look of a fishing hook to lure gullible fishies into their grasp. Zone-tailed hawks even fly in formation with vultures pretending to be one of them, before they break formation and single out prey. It's a very real and logical form of hunting, but the styles that require the least effort are often reserved for the biggest creatures for a reason. Anyway, back to our A-team. Another worm heard the scientific explanation had been given by Rhonda and follows its cue to attack. They rush to the nearby rocks, hoping to get some cover from the worms. By some miracle, it works, and they keep this thing at bay, for now. Now comes the next major issue. They need to get to the truck, and it's way out there across a lot of open ground. Like I said before, these are but minor hindrances to those blessed with the Lord's plot armor. Now, for a normal viewer, aka someone who doesn't have a writing team keeping them alive because they're a main character in a blockbuster film, I would suggest using a sound-based diversion to cover your movements. Grab a ton of rocks, have two people bound across the plane towards the next set of rocks, while the one who stayed behind throws items in an alternate direction and makes noises to keep the worm fixated on them instead. Once two out of the three make it across, the original rear guard moves to a different set of rocks in the same direction as the first two, to avoid having to cross paths with the worm. Rinse and repeat until the first two can safely make it to the truck and pick up the third, hauling ass the entire time. Even then, it's not certain you'd outrun these things though. You've been warned. Not that it matters for these Chads and their Lady Chadette. Instead of anything remotely sensible, after a cozy night's sleep in each other's arms, of course, they flex on all of us peasants with this.
You guys know how to pole vault!
No, Rhonda, I don't. Most dudes I know also wouldn't know how to pole vault, much less when their life depends on it. Seriously, what is it with these scientists Jason Bourne-ing all over the place? How are all these geologists suddenly turning into 80s action heroes? It's like all the Beckys grew up and dedicated their lives to science after a long, hard career of being Becky, with the world requiring them to still use their Becky skills later on. Wait, that is kind of the plot of Jason Bourne, isn't it? I digress. Our team pole vaulted happily ever after to the truck, but unfortunately for them, even the scientist who just gave the explanation didn't listen to her own explanation. These things can sense vibrations and have a pretty decent sense of object permanence. That means unless you come up with some kind of distraction to cover your weird move across the rocks, these things will just follow along underground. Not to mention, they could have just as easily knocked you off your pole by shaking the ground just a little bit, screwing you over even more. You could have made it to the truck with just one sound trap, you guys. I'm not mad, I'm just disappointed. You may be wondering, what does our dream team receive from the desert gods as a reward for what presumably must have been well over an hour of pole vaulting? Well, their reward is not being dead from these terrible, terrible decisions. They just discussed how these things can remember where you are and follow along through the vibrations within the rock formations. It would therefore stand to reason that if you don't somehow distract the worm, it'll just follow you along. What, you guys thought pole vaulting was stealthy? Even against a blind adversary, one would still hear that, along with their schoolgirlish giggling, of course. Incidentally, it's also likely for shits and giggles that the worm didn't actually brutally murder them here. We saw one of these things bury an entire truck earlier in the movie, not to mention drag a full-grown human over a mountain like he was a kite. It could have just as easily hindered the truck from moving at all and forced you into a confrontation. And considering going head-to-head with these things is straight-up seppuku, you likely would not fare that well. When they get back to the general store, after some brewskis, of course, the town finally realizes their gun nuts have just up and left. How would that happen without anyone noticing? See, this is why you guys should have spent less time making fun of them and more time embracing their love of firearms. Let that be a lesson for all you nerds out there making fun of your local survival nuts. One day the zombies may force you to take shelter, and a survivalist may remember you fondly enough to protect your incapable ass. The residents debate important topics once again, like what they should name the worms since they made the discovery, and whether the one wannabe in their crew would rather use a pickaxe or a chainsaw against them if they tried to come at him. Yeah, sure bro, this thing can pretty much lift cars like it's nothing, but you and your pickaxe are gonna stop it all alone. Please, by all means, try. And that's not counting the two other siblings it still has left out there also looking to chomp down on you like a tasty afternoon snack. Meanwhile, Val keeps talking about leaving town, which is honestly just as infuriating. Why would you not just set up with the gummers and kill these things using sound traps, like I suggested? Trying to leave town is just gonna get you killed, since these things can literally hear it happening as you make your escape attempt. If you're now relatively confident, it's only three more of these things. Set up proper defenses and arm up. Even with what's left of your pathetic small-town population, you would still outnumber these things at least 3-1. I'm not saying you can overpower them because of that, but you could definitely be sophisticated in your approach and put your numbers to work. While we're at it, why does it feel like nobody's taking this situation seriously anymore? They all saw the worm's tongue hanging off the truck's rear. They all knew about their murdered neighbors left, right, and center. They all know that their one escape route was cut off, and that the worms are on a direct path towards them. I was wholeheartedly hoping that little Melvin would just get swallowed up whole by a graboid for bouncing that ball off the ground. Let alone for his dumb pranks on the adults that are trying to prepare for a life or death situation. Instead, the graboid just takes his ball away. The adults rush outside when Melvin screams and get caught off guard because of this insufferable little crying wolf BS. I say we should have promoted Melvin to live sound trap right here and now, and used him to put another worm down for good. 7% of the town's population for 25% of theirs seems like a great trade. Besides, we don't really need more Melvins in the world, so sending one off together with a prehistoric monster worm that we also didn't want in our town seems like a win-win. Most of the town's residents run back inside the store for cover, leaving Melvin exposed in some random shed and Nestor atop his trailer's roof. Who cares? There are bigger problems at hand. I'd say one person needs to be on that radio to the Gummers non-stop until they can raise them, since they're our best chance for survival at the moment with their hopefully impressive weapons collection. Meanwhile, the others can put the sound trap idea to work. Hell, Melvin and Nestor could unironically be the ones to create the distraction, seeing as they're already outside and their movement would likely attract the worm. That way, the residents can cover them as they get back to the rest of the group, while also hopefully downing one more Graboid in the process. That is, provided the kids in this town had at least all of one functioning brain cell between them. Unfortunately, they don't, as evidenced by Mindy outside. I don't want to rip on this girl too much, but I just want to call out that she was outside while the last worm attacked. Not only could she have seen it, was she not super distracted, but she could have also felt it. Sure, if her headphones are on max volume, she wouldn't hear screams or anything, but she would feel the goddamn ground shaking, wouldn't she? I guess not. But because of the fact that she's completely oblivious, she's now in danger herself too. You nerds already know what I'm gonna say here. Why waste another perfectly good sound trap? Sure, she's one of two children in this entire town, but for the same reason, it's not like she has many friends to miss her when she's gone. Except maybe Melvin. But hopefully he's gone too. Besides, if Mindy gets gobbled up here, they'd be able to take a worm out with her too. Enormous Graboid in exchange for a child that didn't even bother to look up once to see that she was in enormous danger. Better yet, one oblivious kid and one kid who's just a douchebag in exchange for two enormous Graboids. That leaves us with just one to kill afterwards. I would take that deal.
That good deal.
Nancy finally lays eyes on her daughter, just in time to notice she's about to become Worm Chow. Funny how the residents all located your daughter the instant they stepped outside, but Nancy somehow went looking for her a while back and never found her. That is especially funny considering there's like, what, 10 buildings tops in this immediate area? I think Nancy just caught up in the fantasy of her life wherein she doesn't hear a pogo stick bouncing around 24/7 and let it get the better of her. Fortunately, she snaps out of it and takes Nancy to their home. After Val forced her hand in terms of accountability, that is. I don't get why she retreats into her own home instead of the general store, though, where they're all together and actually have weapons at their disposal. It does work, though, since the rest of the residents attract the Graboids instead. Val takes shelter atop a pickup, while Earl runs back into the store. Rhonda, for some reason, starts bolting towards Melvin. I'm not sure if she was planning to just yeet him at the Graboid for her own survival or what this was supposed to be. Not that it matters, since her foot gets caught on random barbed wire which was conveniently placed here for no reason. Melvin, wholeheartedly deserving to live the rest of his days as excreted worm sh- doesn't even help her. To make matters worse, the barbed wire tightens around her feet, effectively trapping her while the worm slowly reels in his fishing line with a juicy scientist hanging off of it. This is indeed a desperate situation, but fortunately, Val is more than willing to risk his life to literally get into Rhonda's pants, and brings us all some much-welcomed bacon-wrapped plot along with it. After this whole ordeal, the crew sits atop the general store and again debates the same dumb decisions over and over. They are still talking about going for one of the trucks. Dude, it was nothing short of luck that you guys ever made it out with any motorized vehicle. Not to mention, you do not know the exact locations of all three worms, meaning you would have no idea whether or not you're about to bump into one or not. The only way in which this can work is if you take your off-road vehicles off-road, like I suggested, while the others keep the worms distracted as long as possible to buy the driver some time. However, given that it's three worms and they've already killed one with relative ease, just kill them. Making it to another nearby town, signaling rescue, it's cool and all that, but by the time rescue actually makes it back there with you, your whole town could easily have died several times over. And that's if any professional emergency service actually believes you to begin with, which is highly unlikely, even with that tongue on your person as proof. You may as well take care of these things yourself, and since you've now gotten a pretty good understanding of how the Graboids operate, it should be more than doable. From the earlier scenes, it seems as though they've already got the firepower to deal with the task at hand. If for some reason they don't, they could always have someone distract the worms while the brave volunteer attempts to reach the gummers for assistance. The long back and forth gets interrupted by a loud cooler. They manage to unplug it, but alas, trigger the impatient, hungry worm, awaiting its dinner. Apparently, Mr. Graboid was feeling a number 9 from his favorite Chinese restaurant today, which makes for 42% of the population of Perfection dead. They're forced onto higher ground, since their constant screams of anger and drama keep attracting the Graboids towards them. By climbing on top of shelves, most of the crew makes it through a rooftop hatch in the ceiling, all except Rhonda, who gets yeeted out of the window and winds up climbing atop the water tower instead. Oh, and Melvin climbs on top of the shed he was hiding out in. Unfortunately, not becoming worm food just yet. Val finally receives a radio transmission from the gummers, who seem to be but a few miles down the road from them. Strange how they also didn't notice anything happening nearby. Then again, they're also part of the Blissfully Unaware Club, and will likely remain so since again, people weren't told to stay put as a group, and nobody told their fellow man what's going on. I also partially blame how this message is sent across. Val just tells them to get on the roof, rather than any details about the threat at hand or why they should get to higher ground. Heather saw the entire town up on the roofs through her binoculars, and yet waited until Val warned them to do anything with that information, like even just mentioning it. And she still turned on a device that makes a ton of noise with this information in her head, instead of wondering why the entire town is up on the roof, or whether or not this warrants caution from them too. I can't fully blame Heather though, since Val could have taken all of 2 seconds to inform them that the worms hunt using vibrations. It doesn't take long for things to escalate with the worms picking up on their scent. Once the worm shows its ugly face, Bert quickly realizes he's gonna need a bigger gun. With their hunting rifles having little to no effect on target, they try to retreat to their arsenal, but one of the worm's tongues wraps around Bert's foot. Heather makes short work of it using a shotgun, which actually brings up another valid point here. Couldn't we just chop off or destroy all of the worm's tongues and starve it out, since that's the only way that it can eat? They have to use their tentacles to pull in and strangle their prey. That is provided we can't kill it otherwise, but still, might be a way to put the lower caliber weapons to use. Well, that's how I felt anyway, until I saw these guys' arsenal firsthand. Okay, the gummers are just apples. I mean, look at this place. Completely reinforced concrete everywhere that the worm could barely get through, loaded to the teats with weapons and survival supplies. I know they were making fun of them and all, but why would they not at least try to convince the population of the town to follow them to what is effectively a bunker? In this case as well, Bert and Heather already have the perfect setup too, with this beautiful murder hole the one Graboid created for them just now. With the weapons they have, they could take care of them all in just a few hours tops. Just have one of the two make a ton of noise, lure worms into the concrete murder hole, and there you go. Considering radio communications were finally fixed as well, Val could easily provide them with all the info they need to do this successfully. When the small arms fire doesn't put down the worm, Bert finally pulls out the big guns, an elephant rifle. Yep, that ought to do it. I do feel like the smaller caliber bullets do hurt the worm, and can even kill it if hit in a critical area. But if you've got one of these, yeah, use it. And just like that, that's another worm down with only 2 more to go. You may be wondering what their next play will be. Will they bring down a load of weapons for their fellow residents? Advise them to haul out back to the bunker? You'd be sort of thinking in the right direction. But their actual plan is nowhere near that simple. Or smart. Basically, they're still gonna try to get out of town. I'm not sure what for, since they just put down half the worms without really even trying yet. The last 2 worms, because they lost half their family, decide to start expediting their timeline by rocking the general store, the house Nancy and Mindy are holed up in, and the trailer Nestor was hiding atop of. Smart from our dream team letting all these people run off to different, less secure locations. Maybe if they satisfy the worm's hunger for the night, they can make it out of town and find rescue. So why not sacrifice a bunch of supporting characters with room temperature IQs? Seriously though, when the worm drags Nestor off, they just sort of sit there, watching. Why didn't they try distracting the worm? You can definitely grab its attention by screaming at the top of your lungs or wailing on the ground with any object. That would have made any escape attempt more than plausible, rather than just having him absorbed into the dirt. Still entertaining this moronic, let's try and leave town plan, eventually pissed off the worms so much that they decide to add the Gummer's SUV to the collection of no longer roadworthy vehicles in this town. So what does our dream team ultimately decide to do now? They try again with another, even crappier vehicle. Their genius master plan is to use a bulldozer with a trailer attached to it. Once again, enough weapons to go around. Fortifiable survival nut hideout. Only 2 out of the 4 worms remaining, which are very easy to bait using sound traps. How exactly is removing your element of cover out of that equation and setting yourself up incredibly vulnerably on open terrain any better? The threat will be identical, but your ability to handle it on the go would be severely hindered. The time to leave town is long gone, guys. Now's when the killing begins.
Got a plan.
These guys' credit, though. At least they finally think to start using distractions against the attracted by sound worms. If only they hadn't come to that conclusion 1 hour into the movie. Maybe historians in the distant future wouldn't have to wonder why half the population of Nowhere, Nevada evaporated overnight. They plan to use the tractor sitting next to the store to create a diversion and hoof it for the cat. They hypothesize that because it weighs 30 tons, the Graboid wouldn't be able to manhandle it. Right. Yet no. You see how this thing nearly lifted an entire store, followed by a house? Well, the average residential small house weighs about 10 tons. I can guarantee a well-stocked general store would weigh way more. In addition to being firmly planted on the ground underneath it, a bulldozer would not be, and typically weighs only about 20 tons, not 30. Meaning a Graboid would likely just consider this a Meals on Wheels type situation. It's purely the sound traps that's going to either make or horrifically break this already incredibly dumb situation they're about to launch themselves into. And that's without anything going wrong. Which it almost immediately does, of course. And just as Val is out there exposed in the open, it's at this moment that his plot armor has officially run out. With the worm quickly trying to sniff out where its afternoon snack is, as Val is standing still to avoid detection. Fortunately for Val, that's also when the other characters finally decide to actually carry some of the weight of this emergency situation, and finally put some actual effort into attracting the worms towards themselves instead. It works once they start using objects and water, rather than their own vocal cords, and finally gives Val the ability to complete the maneuver to the cat. That bulldozer looks flimsy as hell, and in no way any more stable than any of the buildings in this town, especially not the Gummer's residence. The only reason the plan appears to work at all is purely because the worms just don't actually try. They're only nibbling at the thing with its tiny tongues, but never tries just lifting the thing in the air, as we've seen it do with other vehicles. Whatever. In any case, it gets the rest of the town over to the Gummer's, and while Val is on top of his vehicle screaming his lungs out, talking about how smart the creatures that let them go all the way to the other side of town are, they're still riding on the get out of town plan. Dude, Bird is literally making IEDs on his rooftop and has an actual elephant rifle, which he has successfully killed a worm with already, even from right there on the rooftop, baiting these things to attack you before you clown on them with some high caliber rifle rounds or explosive justice is still the play.
Watch these ammo boxes!
This just lost all common sense to me right about here. Dude's loading up enough firepower to not only kill all the remaining worms, but all life in that town, multiple times over, easily. He's got proof that his residence is significantly more effective at providing cover from the worms, and yet he still chooses to join whatever the hell this extraction plan is. Isn't the whole point of being a survival nut that stocks up weapons and canned goods in your homemade bunker that you stay in said bunker when it's the fan? As they leave and we get the perfect shot of this guy's insanely fortified house, he even complains about leaving a top-notch water and air filtration system plus 5 years of food behind in his bomb shelter, along with the rest of his guns. Yeah, this is too stupid for words. It's designed to withstand bombs, perfectly held up against the worms, and yet you're leaving it behind to go shooting giant Jurassic worms atop of a bulldozer in the middle of the desert. you and your wife are right to be crying. Except you should be crying over how profoundly dumb you both are. They inevitably, very slowly of course, make it over to the rock formation nearby that was supposed to be their sanctuary. And surprise, surprise, the worms are right there too. Turns out they even laid a trap to render their bulldozer useless, forcing them to fight in the open no matter what.
Eat this!
But because Bert's got a Bert, this still turns into a massive W for Team Worm Food, with him nearly capping one of the worms insurgent style. Unfortunately, it didn't kill the beast, so there's still two of them out there. Not that this should concern them, they've got plenty of bombs and ammo to go around. Their new plan is to use the bombs as sound-based deterrents. So instead of throwing the bombs into another direction than the one they're running towards, they plan to throw it right at the rock formation, because they won't be able to stand the sound. Uh-huh, right. Or, you know, just have one guy spill some water like Rhonda did earlier, away from the rest of the group, giving the team a chance to run. Why overcomplicate this situation with constant new plans? As they run, the worms come straight back towards them, further proving that a sound trap could have easily de-risked this situation altogether. I mean, they make it, but with like a millisecond to spare. I know it's movie plot BS, but we even see Mindy tripping at one point during this run. Any tiny thing could have gone wrong and you'd all have been toast without a proper distraction. Not to mention dispersion between yourselves, so the worm can't just nom all of you in one bite. Once atop the rock with the worms making circles around them like sharks in the water, they again start talking about how to leave the rock before the gummers finally come to their senses and realize this plan sucked from the get-go. Of course, your fortified bunker was a better option than whatever the hell this was meant to be. You had already beaten one of these things. You had the perfect setup, but you blew it. So now you have to listen to angry Kevin Bacon tell you why he's right and you're wrong. Again, coming to the same conclusions as before, they try to use bait to their advantage to make the worms surface before feeding them a bomb. Essentially, the concept is an IED fishing line with an active bomb on it that they want to get the worm to gobble up. And it works like a charm. Since this plan isn't completely flawed in every imaginable way possible, now all that's left to do is bait the last remaining worm out of hiding, before elephant rifling or bombing it to death. It's nowhere near that bad of a threat now with just one lone worm left. You could try rocks one more time or just yeet Melvin at the last worm and bomb them both, since it'd be cruel to have him experience being eaten alive and all. Unfortunately, the rocks don't work quite as well the second time around, as it does in fact turn out that these things learn. The worm pulls the bomb down to the depths before launching it perfectly onto the bag of remaining bombs atop the rock. When part of the crew is forced off the rock to take cover, the worm takes this opportunity to strike, embracing its fate as the final kamikaze worm trying to bring honor to its ancestors. Rhonda, Val, and Earl get caught in the open. The others try to bait the worm into leaving them alone, but it appears it's finally caught up with the human's tricks. Val doesn't want to waste the last bomb since they just die up on that rock in 3 days. First off, Val, it's about 36 hours at best here in the desert. Secondly, Bert still has the elephant rifle, so there are ways to kill the last worm even without the bomb. But hey, you do you. The trio runs to the edge of the cliffs nearby before setting off the bomb right behind the last worm, scaring it so much that it just runs off the cliff to its death. With that, the worm infestation's finally over for our residents in this small valley town. Of our original characters, we're only left with about half the town's population when everything's said and done. Had they gone about this differently, immediately rounding up the entire town and moving on over to the Gummers' residence, I think that they could have significantly mitigated the percentage of their town's population being converted to worm food. For this reason, I firmly believe Tremors was beaten. Moral of the story, freedom requires firepower.